in.
Now the third. Now you got it. Well, my name is Tony McGregor. That's who I am. What I'm doing is trying to spread my personal experience through house dance culture or hip hop culture. I teach on a regular basis in New York City, and I basically get offered to go around the world and teach the basics of what I've done over the past maybe 25 years as far as dance is concerned, starting from breakdance, popping, hip-hop, social dances, to house dance. The past, basically, coming up, I was involved in a lot of different things. I saw grandparents, mom, aunt, uncles, saw them doing hustle. Grandmother watched her do Lindy Hop. Me, it was just, I came up trying to hustle, pop, break dance, hip hop. So my style is a melting pot of everything I've encountered as far as things, my personal life, things I've experienced, good and bad, and also, you know, from a martial arts perspective as well. I trained karate years ago as a child, and when I got older, I got involved in Filipino style of fighting called Kali, a screamer, or Arnis, and also Indonesian form, which is called Pencak Silat.
Try to call all dance style you related with until now. Yeah.
Breaking, popping, locking, hip hop. Tap dance, jazz, ballet. Those are all the things that I've encountered. Lindy Hop. Where I grew up in Newark, New Jersey. I would stay back and forth between New Jersey and Long Island as I got to like a teenager, late teens. 17 to 19 years old, at a friend's house. But going back to my family, as far as I know, my family's from Newark, New Jersey. When you go back further to my grandparents, she was from the South. Her family was Native American. And the things that I worry about, it's just being able to pay bills and survive in terms of dancing, just to leave a legacy where it's a positive vibe. And I worry about something that I take passionate, you know, not really growing. Because a lot of things that my peers and I have done kind of seems as if we're ahead of our time, and the things have come out and we have done them, but as everything does, it gets old. So a lot of things that we've done have been considered as old. However, new days and times, things that are old are now being rediscovered and are really being renamed and considered as something new. So I kind of worry that when we do things, we make a mark and it's not recognized. And if it's not recognized, we are erased from history. And it's important that I think that as a street dancer, because I've never been trained in a school, I think that it's important for us to get the credit that we do. when we do things. So I worry that we will be erased and not acknowledged for any accomplishments that we have provided.
What are you doing to prevent it? Or how can it be prevented?
Well, I don't know if it can be prevented, but because of the new technology, what's going to help is the fact that we have the internet, and you can't erase the whole internet. So it has dates and times, and the fact that we are traveling, the masses of us, which is not many, but we are traveling and meeting new people, and the new people are one. The one are linked to 50. The 50 are linked to 150, and it's actually spreading like a wildfire. So even if we are not acknowledged by name, we are acknowledged by face and by the styles that we have been a part of spreading. I started with dancing. We would have a lot of family gathering during holidays, and my grandmother would cook a lot, so we would all gather, and everybody would just turn on the music and exchange. You know, it was just one culture in the household being spread from the eldest to the youngest. And, you know, it was just something that we did with the family. You know, cousins would come by, my grandmother's nephews, and they would come by, and it was just a big, to me, at the time I was a kid, it was just a big party that I enjoyed. We all had time. Today it seems as if we have no time, really. Everything has a purpose. If you have a time where you visit your family, it's because of a bad situation or because you need a favor. Before, it was just mandatory that you sat in and you got an opportunity to talk to the eldest member or the older member of your family, to the youngest member. And now I feel like that doesn't happen. At least in my world, it doesn't happen.
Ah!
a lot of inspiration comes from me not wanting to fail. Yeah, it's hard when you have nothing and you grab a little piece of something, you don't want to fail. So that's one way. Another way is you have people who are behind you who look up to you. So you kind of get put into a position where you become the leader. In my family, I was used to family members being leaders and taking on responsibility and leadership roles. The problem with that was everybody got old or everybody got sick. And now the same people that got old and sick aren't here anymore. So it puts you in a position where you live and learn. And you have to assume leadership. And when you have kids, you have to show them a better way. So you have to take the responsibility and you have to lead.
You have something very militaristic in you. Where did it come from? Something like a commando, a special elite. You have this focus and you have this elite thing. You have this strong. Feel something like that in you?
Well, yes. Again, it goes back to not wanting to fail. Wanting so bad to succeed, and also from the training that I received in the Philippines, it kind of gave me a different perspective on a lot of situations, because their culture, even though it's an art form as well, was a situation where, again, it was passed down from eldest to youngest. So when I looked at how things were passed down, it was a chain of command, and things were set aside for certain individuals and put into a line where you had to follow the steps to lead to that same path where you are the leader. So because of these things that I've encountered, with a child coming up, with a grandmother leading the household, a mom leading my household, and then going to the future where I am the only male in the family, to dealing with a sergeant training me how to kill or survive. So this is where I basically learned those skills. It wasn't intentionally, it was just what I learned from observation.
And from being a commando also? Being trained to be a commando? I hammer on it because I feel it.
It needs to be heard.
Yeah.
Because it gives people a disciplinary standpoint so that they understand that things are in line.
Yeah.
Sometimes people go outside of the box, and every time you go outside of the box, it's not necessary. Mm-hmm. Things are handed down for a reason. You don't have to just take them over.
Yeah.
They're given.
Yeah. We'll be right back.
mom was a nurse. You know, she worked years and years, and you know, I mean, things to show for it. She had things to show. Simple stuff. Clothes, jewelry, a roof over our head. But me, I looked at it as if it wasn't enough, because I would see her situation dealing with my father. They weren't together. I would see her and my stepfather. He's a good guy, just not focused like he should be. Because you have a guy who was focused, a woman who's focused, unstoppable combination. But when you have other people on the outskirts looking in, they start saying, hey, why do you let her control things? Hey, I know you guys are doing well. Can you help me out? You start to get things like that, of that nature, and they start to disrupt the thinking. It could go either way, male or female. In this case, it was in his direction. He was distorted, which is things put in his vision. He couldn't see clearly, and he started messing up. So again, my mother and me together, just us two, for years and years. I didn't have to do anything. All I had to do was go to school and work. But me, I saw like all the hard work she did, there was really no reward. So I took myself and I put myself in the street. I worked, I invested money while I worked in the corporation I worked for. So every 100, they put 100. By the time I was 19 or 20, I had four bank accounts. I had shares in Allstate, insurance, life insurance, car insurance, house insurance, Sears and Roebuck, a department store, one of the biggest department stores in the States. I don't know if it's over here, but they sell everything in the store. So if you look at it from that aspect, I had things going for myself. I worked two jobs, but I still stayed in the street.
What do you mean by that, you know? Street.
I was around the riffraff. The guys who sold drugs and everything. Robbed people, I was there. I didn't partake in the robbing part because that's not in my heart. The selling drugs part, I did that before. I made a lot of money. A lot of money. When I made enough money, I told her, listen, I've been doing this for a long time. You don't have to work so hard anymore. Take a break. I want to help. What do you mean? Because for years, she did not approve. No, no, I don't want this money. I don't want this. But me, I was like, listen, no arrest, no police, no nothing. You've been working over 20 plus years. You don't have nothing to show for it. All these years I've done this, I could buy whatever you want. You know? Anything you want, let's do it. That's how much love I have for you. So, we bought a house. Me and my mom, we got the house built from the ground up. As soon as they started, she got diagnosed with cancer. So when she got diagnosed with cancer, she said, yeah, it's gonna be okay. Don't worry, I'm gonna take care of everything. No problem, it's okay. I said, all right, let's do this. Don't be afraid. We gotta do it. She says, okay, we're gonna do it. 6 months later, she's in the hospital. The doctor says to me, your mother's got a 30% chance of survival. And I say, okay, she got a 30% chance. Oh, okay. So from that point, I just did everything. For the next year and a half, she got better for 2 months and worse for the next year, whatever changed after, until that was it. By the time she passed away, they finished the house. The house was supposed to be finished 1 year early. When she passed away, that's when they finished the house. So at the time they did it, I didn't take responsibility for the house because it was supposed to be me and my mother. You know, only child. So me and my mother's bond is so tight. Mm-hmm. The house finished, she passed away, that was it. I had to regroup emotionally, physically. For a good 3-4 months, I couldn't dance. I didn't want to dance, nothing. When she passed, I was 36. I'm 43 now. It was off and on. I stopped. I started when I was 16. I did it for a few years. Worked the 2 jobs, always worked. Always. I never was just a street guy. I always worked. I was always about business. So I understood that you had to work. It wasn't about just being out on the street. And she would always talk about that. It's not about that. You don't have to do that. But I put myself in that position. I put myself in that position because I saw at the time advantages and the disadvantages. Mm-hmm. And the advantages were very lucrative. The disadvantages, well, we know what can happen. You can get hurt,
killed,
or incarcerated. You have to make the decision. I just wanted so much for my mom because I saw her struggle so much. She made so much money, but never anything. Dance is an escape in a lot of cases for me, you know? It's getting away from that. You know, it's interesting. I was talking to Yuxin. He said, yo, I'm so happy when I see your way, man, sometimes, you know, a lot of times, really. He says, because I could tell when you come away, it's like a vacation for you. I could see you're so happy and relieved because it's so much stress on us at home, so much. You know, my mom in 06, a few years go by, my cousin. A few years go by, more like two years go by after my cousin, which was my mom's niece, her mother.
All cancer.
Almost my whole family, an immediate family, is gone. It's just me and my younger cousin and my mother's youngest sister. That's it. My uncle, he died a long time ago. He was in the house scene. He used to tell me about it. He was in a house of extravaganza. He was a vulgar. Of course, he lived that lifestyle. He was gay. People don't realize that there's a line of command, a chain that things should have to go through. I can't just go into a college and just be a scholar. You can't just have a scholar come on the street and be a street representative. Two different worlds. Everybody's trying to be on top. So you have the young kids, they ask for influence, they ask for guidance, but they don't really seek it. They take what they can take and they try to do things. I've even heard of young guys in Midwest, in the States, I met your boy in the Midwest. Who's my boy? Oh, this guy. Oh yeah, what was he doing? Oh, he came out there, I saw him doing the moves that you guys were doing in the circle. Oh yeah? Yeah. And then he was trying to ask my friend if they could set classes up for him. Oh really? Yeah. He said he'll take like $50, $100. What? So it's like you're undermining something that we're doing. We're trying to give you guidance in doing it and you're undermining us. Oh, you want to get them guys? But they're going to charge you for here? Oh, they're going to charge you like $250, $350 a class. I do it for $100. So you started getting stuff and things happening in that nature. Mm-hmm. And that messed up some of the opportunities at home. Now it's on a whole different level because it went someplace else. It's something that may have been needed, but I just think it should have been gone about being done in a different way. I don't think it should have been done the way that it was done.
What's wrong?
Well, you had, for a while, you had people having sessions. And in the sessions, you know, you're supposed to do things and ask as a person coming in the session who's kind of like misinformed or who's not really skilled, ask, and then you continue to try to work on what it is, yes, that you asked. But it started being in this a situation where people were coming in and the session was like a class. So you got me teaching a class for $20, someone else teaching a class for $15 or $18, and then you got a session. I might have 12 or 13 people in my class, but you got 35 people in your session. So you got a $5 session / class, which it undermines the fact that you have a class. And the class is the actual setting to teach. So I just think, you know, these lines should be drawn and should be respected. You got guys who are considered the top people. And those are basically the guys from my collective. And you got guys that are directly under us who we taught first. That was the Japanese. They invested the most money in us initially. And if you look at their history, this is what they do. They take your idea and they try to make it better than what you've done with it. So the Japanese took interest in us and they invested time, money, and themselves into getting the product from us, which is the art form. Right slightly after, you have the French, who went through that chain, the Japanese, and actually ran into us. The Japanese will never let anybody take over. It's just their culture. So now you have guys teaching things where we have names and we can categorize certain things. These brothers are in other areas and they're doing the same things, but when people have questions, they can't answer the questions properly. So I think what happened is it caused a beef because they felt like they were being undermined, but they weren't. When you're doing business, the last thing you think about, I mean, at least where I'm coming from, is someone else and trying to chop someone else down. I'm not trying to do that. I want to make it so that it's better. And I felt like if there was a situation where that was thought, I felt the relationship was good enough where we could have been approached. Because if we're looked upon as OGs, anytime you have a OG in this particular art form, you should be able to ask. You should be able to ask any questions. The French, however, they had something special because they took something that we embraced and they turned it into a bigger event than we did. We had battles, but ours were in the club. They were more intimate. Great business. Anytime you can fill up a full arena, great business. So that's what happened. Before, people would get up. People wanted to battle. Oh, I want to battle. But now, in terms of battling, the U.S. feels as if we go do a battle, it's going to be on European soil, and we're going to lose anyway. Because the judges don't squat. So this is how they feel. So that's why when you have representation here, you don't have much United States representation. You got people like me that's an OG that people feel the skill set is too advanced, it's not fair. We're competing in the battles and having fun. And people are like, oh, you guys shouldn't be doing that. We should be doing that. But when they have it, they don't come. They don't come because they don't feel like they're going to get a fair shake.
Do you see a lot of American representation in forever?
No, because they feel as if it's a French-ran machine. So that's how they feel. That you can solve it is for people to be hired and seen. This is the problem.
What?
People from the States to be hired and seen. But you know what the problem is? The problem is sometimes when they're hired, they're not themselves. They're not. Sometimes power is too much. So they're not themselves. So when you have that happening, it's never going to be controlled. It's not flagrant, meaning it's not in your face. It's very, in a very subtle and respectable way. You know, a few times, we all sat back and we talked about it. Sometimes guys, I think I made a bad decision, maybe that time. But you have all the key essentials not to make a bad decision. So why this time? Why the time after that? Why the time after that? Come on. make the right choice. You got to get the right Americans, because sometimes, again, people are very judgmental, and if they are not feeling something today, they may be feeling something tomorrow. We're the only ones trying to break it down, but as soon as we come in, you'll have a situation where I'll battle someone, or somebody affiliated would battle someone with me, and you could clearly see the disparity in skill, but the person with the most skill set is not going to win. And then you have people trying to explain to me or somebody that's my age about a battle in their 20s. So, you know, for me, it's a good perspective to kind of listen, because you want to hear what other people have to say. But I'm still relevant because I judge, I battle, and I just don't really think that it's a time or place for them to say what they need to say, because it's not something that's constructive. It's a degrading statement or move of action. It should be in a way where it's respectful. If it's done respectfully, nobody has a choice but to respect it and move on from it.
So Americans are more related to the Japanese market?
When you look at what's going on, yeah, because there's no real market when you look at the French market. It's other countries in Europe, and everybody would rather go to the other countries to do things, because they even know. And see, people don't really pay close attention. You look at the States, where we come from, shit is hard. You look at the French in Paris, shit is hard for them in Paris. They can't make revenue like they need to. They gotta go other places, just like we gotta go other places. The problem is, I happened to be at a friend's house one day. I was in Montreal. And he let me hear a conversation. There was an organizer that contacted him. He couldn't do the job. So he asked, yo, why don't you contact Tom or Khalif and those guys? Let them do it. Woke me up. I'm like, yeah. He's like, just don't say anything. I'm listening. Person is, oh, well, you know, I got the government money. And if I pay for Khalif or Tom, I got to pay more money. For these guys, they're in Europe, so I only got to pay 200 to 300 euro, and then I could give them 800 or 1,000 euro and be done. Tone, oh, Khalif, I got to pay them €1,000 for the ticket, and then I got to pay them another 2,500 or €2,000. Like, it's too much. And he said, well, you're getting fronted the money. Why is it too much? But they didn't want to do it. Asia has the market, yeah, and they have the power too. The thing is, for us, mind, body, and soul, and this is the advantage. We still have it. Not many people have the information, yeah, or the skill that we have, or the knowledge.
Yeah,
it's only a few of us. Yeah. I named only a few on each side.
Yeah.
If we were gone, the culture's already expanding. It's superseding our control as it is, trying to contain it. It's not containable. But it's strange because if you sit and you ask a judge, what do you want? What is your criteria for the dance? Some of them will say, offbeat. If offbeat, I don't watch. Some of them will say, I like, you know, if you do your footwork on point, I like, if you listen to the music, I like. So, if you listen to the music, it's the same as if you're offbeat, if you don't listen to the music, right?
Yeah.
Same point. So, if you stick by the point that you just expressed, you shouldn't have any problems. But you'll have someone offbeat, they will pick them, and then once you address that, they will make an excuse. I just want to see him this round. He's better, but he lost. And we don't have that. It's an opinion at times. I mean, it's honest. It's a mistake, but, you know, I mean, this is called or considered human error. So to actually just dissolve the problem, it's going to be hard. Very hard. Because the market is so saturated at this point with dancers from all over. And I haven't been all over. And people that I'm down with haven't been all over. And if you look at the people dancing now, they're doing things that we've done and we've passed on to people. So it's never really going to change. Hopefully it'll get better, but I don't think anything is going to change unless you take it from just a battle and it goes back to the party environment again. And I don't see that really happening no time soon, because the event is too big. You know, some of us talk about it. Tomorrow it'll be an event. You go to this country, another event. You go to another country, another event. All battles. Nobody talks about partying anymore. They battle. Soon as the battle is over, soon as they lose, okay, see you. Where are you going? The party's upstairs. Oh, I go home.
They are not related to...
No connection.
No, there's no connection.
None. I'm here for one purpose and one purpose only. I want to win that money and the free trip. Oh, I didn't win? Okay, let's go. See, we had a different feeling when it came to this. There was no prize money every week. There was a contest, one in a million. And other than that, that was it. I think I should have traveled more, sooner, and started doing this a lot sooner. I was doing it still consistently, but I was working. Like I told you, I always kept a job. Dealing with guys on the street, they don't know anything. Nothing. Some of the guys can't half count. And I saw that they had a potential. See, me, it's different from me. I don't prey on people. I just see that you have an ability, and I try to allow you to acknowledge the fact that you have a greatness about you. Everybody has a greatness, but they don't have people in their lives to tell them that. So when I teach the class, I relate it to what used to happen on the street. I used to tell guys, listen, you're making money, put it away. Do something with your money. Don't just stay out here for nothing. So when I teach the class, it's the same. Listen, you guys, you took the class, ask questions. You paid your money. Anything you need from me while I'm your teacher, I'm basically serving you. Let me know what it is you need. What do you want? I'm here for you. You're paying for a service. I'm trying to give you the best service possible. When you leave here, if you got any questions, ask. I got as much time as you have. So it's the same. The drive is the same. It's no different. That was trying to survive without being in trouble. And when I say trouble, I mean hurt, in jail. When I'm in here, it's the same. I'm in a place, I don't know anybody. I'm just meeting people. So I give them my all, my best, because it's a possible relationship where it can be frequent flyer miles. I can be like this. And I look at that as the same. I developed a new friendship. This is a whole different scenery for me. I don't have to come in with the same baggage and make the same mistakes. I can start fresh. Mm-hmm.
You and spirituality, what does spirituality mean for you?
Well, it's just a way of thinking when it comes in terms of spirituality. Certain things you just won't allow yourself to do or go overboard with certain things in terms of spirituality. It keeps you in check. You got to have a newfound respect, and with that newfound respect, you won't go past a certain point because of your spirituality. If you believe wholeheartedly in something, it will not allow you to go over that point. So it's important for a means of control. One, two, three. Just moving left and right. That's it. You just shift your weight very subtle, which is easy. That's all. Very subtle. Don't stress. Don't pull. I can't believe you did this.
Shit.
See, it's not.
what I'm doing is called the Spider-Man. And Sekou's wife, his wife, called it the name. Because we were just doing it. And I put a bug in Sekou's ear a while ago about it. I forgot all about it. But he came to me and said something about it. And when he said it to me, I was like, yo, that was a good idea you thought about. He was like, you gave me the idea. So I'm saying I gave him the idea. He's saying he gave me the idea. It's all screwed up. Anyhow, we did it together, and we just compared notes as we did it. So we have similar core moves, but our specialty moves are our specialty moves. But all the stuff that you see us doing basically, on a basic level, up top, that we can actually do on the ground, we sat there and we talked about it, gave it names, and we worked out rigorously just doing it over and over and over and over with a training regimen for it and everything. If you don't have the physical presence...
you must be there. Yeah, you would get hurt.
Yeah. It's been a few years now.
Yeah.
Yeah. We've been doing this a few years now. It's been a minute. We just got better and better. The more we did it, the better and better we got.
Man.
Cause I'm telling you, the first year, everything was sore. Chest, biceps, wings, the neck, the head. Just like that all day. Get up. Oh, I'm good. Walk around, eat, go to sleep. You get up. Oh, the back. Oh, so much. With the group,
yeah.
I basically try to position myself as a soldier or the protector. I don't really speak much. I let them speak because I came months after. Some of them started before me, so I just let them speak. I'm not really a speaker. I like to do things. And that's why when you said earlier when we had the discussion, since determination, that's how I kind of feel. I'm more of a, being that I was a loner all my life, I've always had to prove myself. So I let them talk and I'll demonstrate if I have to. That's how I feel. I'm one of the oldest, but at the same time, I'm one of the youngest in the group.
Mm-hmm.
People are 44, 45, I'm 43.
Mm-hmm.
I'll be 44. In a few more weeks, but I'm still younger. I'm still younger. So,
yeah.
You know, it's to me, it falls back in line with the chain of command is given. And I watched how my grandmother ran the household, and she was in charge. So I watched that. I learned how to respect. Even if you don't agree, you still respect it.
Mm-hmm.
And when you have an opportunity, if it's asked of you, you speak about it.
Mm-hmm.
If not, you don't hurt anybody by walking away. Mm-hmm. So sometimes I could walk away. I don't have an ego. I'd rather have a friend than to have an ego. Influence-wise, we have a big influence in the house culture, house dance culture, but normal society, they don't even really care in the States. I'd say our influence is so big in other parts of the world, we probably could come and live for about 2 or 3 years and really do well if you market and represent yourself right. You'll live 3 years hassle-free, no issues, no anything. After that, when it starts getting to 5 and 10, I'm noticing a lot of my brethren going places, and their welcomes are not received very well anymore. I don't know if it's because people see them on a regular basis, whereas before it wasn't common, or if it's just people being rebellious. Because I really don't know. I've heard both sides. From people living there saying, well, you know, when you live here, it's not the same as when you visit. I've heard that. I've also heard people say, well, you know, he's got a nasty attitude. But then when I talk to the people that I know, the reason for the nasty attitude is because people are giving misinformation about a history, a dance style and a culture that I've been doing since I was a kid. Never looking for any money. Just doing it because it's something that I grew up doing with my family and I just love to do. Mm-hmm. You know, now it's such a big business that you have people who may win a contest and automatically they're the people that everyone wants to see and learn from. And I'm not saying they don't have anything to offer, because everybody has valuable things to offer. But it's just real odd, I find it, that you've been dancing for 2 years and you got a person dancing for 20, not even 20, 10 years, and you would rather go deal with the person for 2 years than somebody who is just as sharp for 10. I don't get that. We have two divisions.
Yeah.
Basically, we're all underlined mop top. This is all of us collectively. But in terms of how we market and strategize, you have Elite Force and then you have Dance Fusion. Elite Force, they can dance house, yes. But most cases, they represent hip hop. The only one who represents house on a consistent level is Ejo Wilson. Then you have Dance Fusion. We all represent house. We all can rep when it comes to hip hop as well. So you have two groups, which is actually one group. So on the Elite Four side, you have Stretch, Buddha Stretch. You have Link, Henry Link. You have Brooklyn Terry, Ejo Wilson, Bobby Mileage. We're going to stop it there. Now I'm going to go to the Dance Fusion side. Dance Fusion side, me, myself, and I, Tony McGregor, Sekou Haru, Marjorie Smart. Very strong, very graceful, but really strong, you know? She has cancer too, you know? And she's had it for a while and is dealing. And she looks good. Very determined to be a woman amongst men.
Uh-huh.
You don't really have this, you understand? You have women being around men to be with women, or not with anybody, but she's striving to be amongst men. Khalif Sellers, Hero, Nordico, those are two Japanese that are actually Dance Fusion in the group, not affiliated, in the group. I'm gonna stop it there, but we got more people. So do you want the other two? Okay, Shannon and Shannon. One Shannon is Which Way Sha, the other Shannon is Shan-S. And of course, we have a lot of people that are down and that are affiliated around us. So this is my talented crew. Just being around people with such talent allows you to learn and develop. That's it.
Mm-hmm.
Just being around interesting people allows that and pushes you to be able to do that.
Mm-hmm.
They're my teachers. Things I saw on the street, reactions to certain movements, sounds, just situations in personal hardship, or things that I achieved that I felt were great. Well, pretty much like me, they're doing the same thing. They're just going all over the globe, spreading information about how we came into the game and what is our inspiration, you know, judging events, teaching workshops, camps, basically the same stuff, same things I'm doing, you know.
Okay.
My grandmaster, he just put so many things into order. Actually, learning from him, I actually learned how to teach my craft because he had a format and a method, and he had levels to teaching. It went from being something difficult to allowing you to be free to think to being fun. Also, you actually learn without remembering mentally. It became muscle memory. And instead of just learning and, oh, I gotta think about that, it would just happen because of repetition. Rep, over and over and over and over and over. And because you program the body naturally, it just happens instinctively. And that is the best teacher.
Mm-hmm.
If you compare what I'm saying to an everyday person, you'll understand, like, in the morning, you wake up, you go to the restroom. You don't think about it. You just hop up and you go. It's something that happens naturally. You don't lay in the bed, sit up at 2 o'clock in the morning and say, I'm gonna go to the bathroom now. No. You could be asleep, you'll just wake up because the body informs you it's time to go. And this is what happened when I started learning from him. I started understanding everything is related. One thing is just an extension of another. Based off of what type of day, depends. I could be in a bad mood, but if the music is very deep and techie, I might go to a place where I feel free, which is just imagining and being kind of cartoonish, revisiting things from childhood where things were like easy or a great feeling. If the music is very vocal and it touches the soul, then maybe I kind of relax and I feel slighted a little bit to lean towards being softer and more gentle. Just depends on how the music touches the heart.